Morning, everyone. It's 9:04 at this time. We're going to give members a few more minutes to arrive. We're going to get things started. I would like first for the gentleman, Mr. Bloom, to lead us in the pledge.
Please stand.
Thank you, everyone. Before we officially get started, I wanted to remind everyone that this meeting is being recorded, required to disclose that in accordance with the Wiretap Act. And given the nature of this small number of members on the committee, I would like to give each member an opportunity to just briefly introduce themselves, and we'll start with Representative Keller to my left.
Good morning, and thank you for being here today, and I want to thank Representative Ivankovich for having this meeting. I'm Fred Keller. I represent Union and Snyder counties in the General Assembly, and that is the 85th Legislative District.
Stephen Bloom from the 199th District, which is Cumberland County, and also very pleased to be part of this committee and looking at some big questions, some of the questions that are maybe in that category called important but not urgent that we sometimes skip over in the legislature. So we're really excited to get in here and dig into some long-term policy solutions. So thank you all for testifying today, and appreciate your being here.
We'll give Representative Rabb a minute. So before I hand things over to my Democratic lead, Representative Daley, I just wanted to briefly outline the purpose of this subcommittee. The purpose of the subcommittee is to modernize and reform Pennsylvania's tax structure. In order to accomplish this, we want to analyze all existing economic and socioeconomic and demographic data, try to figure out exactly where our trends are in Pennsylvania, identify what is going on in other competing states, and also try to figure out what it's like for the existing taxpayer that pay the taxes here in Pennsylvania and those who don't. And lastly, we want to come up with a tax strategy, ultimately, to vote out of this subcommittee and into the full finance committee that would develop a fair, stable, predictable, efficient, and structured tax structure to foster population growth and business growth here in the state of Pennsylvania, while at the same time giving the necessary revenue to the state to carry out its public mission and its programs. For the testifiers, if we can, keep our comments to about 5 minutes. We have all of your written testimony, but the real value will come, I think, with some of the exchanges between yourselves and the sitting lawmakers. With that, I'll hand things off to Representative Daley, and then if Representative Rabb can introduce himself.
Thank you, Chairman Ivankovich. Good morning, everybody. I'm Mary Jo Daley, and I represent the 148th District in Montgomery County. I am obviously a member of the Finance Committee, and so I was really pleased to be selected to be on this select committee because I think it gives us an opportunity as a small group of the Finance Committee to really look at the tax structures in Pennsylvania and for moving, you know, hopefully provide information back to the full committee regarding it. And in my view, right now, Pennsylvania is out of balance. And when I say that, I'm looking at the budget, I'm looking at the tax policy, because we took 4 extra months this year to pass the full budget. Obviously, issues related to how we were going to pay for it. And I'm hoping that by educating ourselves more on the tax structures and what's possible, what's worked, what hasn't worked, what's working in other states, we can really improve the job that we do on the Finance Committee. And I also am thinking about the idea of including, I've been a proponent of including tax credits or tax expenditures as part of the discussion. I serve on the Appropriations Committee, and we give great depth of conversation and hearing to appropriations, but we are not always talking about that side of tax expenditures that minimize the amount of money coming into the state. So I think that that's an important part of what the job is here. So I appreciate your being here and look forward to the discussion. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Chris Rabb. I'm state representative from the 200th Legislative District in Northwest Philadelphia. And this is about my 11th month in office. And so I'm honored to be on the Select Subcommittee. This is really important work, and particularly from my perspective as a new public servant, coming into the alphabet soup that is state government bureaucracy, understanding all of the different taxes and various fiefdoms and histories behind how this happened and that happened really provides me a perspective on what I've walked into and what is possible. And also taking a step back and having the discipline and vision to look at what are the best practices in other states and kind of the origins of how we got to this point here and how we can work together in a bipartisan fashion going forward. So I'm really appreciative to be a part of this select subcommittee. Thank you very much.
Thank you, colleagues. So we're going to get the hearing underway. This is the first hearing for the Select Subcommittee on Tax Modernization and Reform. The hearing will focus on the Pennsylvania taxes and the history of taxes in Pennsylvania. We'll have additional hearings going forward to talk about tax policy and to learn more. But at this time, I'd like to introduce Sue Capella and Jennifer Schultz from the Penn State Data Center.
Thank you very much. Again, I'm Jennifer Schultz from the State Data Center. Thank you very much for the opportunity to be here today and for the opportunity to present the testimony. We're just going to do a short review of the overarching demographic trends in the state of Pennsylvania. So to start, Pennsylvania is a very slow growth state.
Jennifer, if you can please just pull the microphone a little bit closer.
Sorry about that. Pennsylvania is a very slow growth state, so 1950 our population was approximately 10.5 million and has increased to about 12.7 million as of the last decennial census. In the last two decennial periods, the population of the state has increased 3.4%, so very small changes. In the most recent population estimate for 2016, the state's population actually declined for the first time since the 1980s. Of course, one data point does not make a trend, so we will continue to follow that population figure. But what we would expect to see is a continuation of that very slow growth between the decades. So with the 2020 census, maybe the around the 3% increase again, or maybe slightly smaller than that. Another trend we're seeing, the school age population has declined since 2010. So as the population of younger people in our state declines and the population age 65 and older increases, what we'll see is a shrinking of our working age population. So the state's population age 65 and older was about 15% of the population in 2010. And that is projected to increase to 23% of the population by 2040. So that is a very significant change. Next, briefly talk about, there has been a change in the movement we would call out of the cities. For many years or decades, the population of the cities was declining and people were moving to townships. So we saw some very large increases in the movement to our townships, almost a 10% through the decades. That has pretty much reversed. So we're seeing population actually returning to the cities. So for the first time we saw, it's a very slight increase, but actually a positive increase in the population moving to cities. And then sort of flatlining in the boroughs. So there hasn't been much movement in or out of the boroughs, retailly growing. However, if you look at the municipal map, you will see there are areas that are fairly flat within that or actually declining. And the reverse is also true. We say that the western portion or the northern tier of the state, for the most part, is flat or declining in population. But you can see, I believe it's along the I-79 corridor, you'll see growth. You can also see pockets of growth along the northern tier if you look at the municipal population change. So you need to look at the different levels of detail to get the real picture there. But Asian population has grown over 70%. and the Hispanic population has more than doubled in our state since 2000. So those are the statewide trends. Again, if you look at that in more detail at the lower geographic levels, you will see varying.
Thank you. That was probably one of the most concise overviews that I've...
I think we were almost unprepared.
I think we were almost a little unprepared for how fast that was. It's like the kid doing homework right before right before the class. So I'd just like to very briefly move to move the questions. Recognize Representative Daley.
Thank you for that analysis. So I'm from the southeastern part of Pennsylvania, and we're seeing, I think, population growth in my area. And I know that my schools are also experiencing, the public schools are experiencing growth. So my question was going to be, does the school-age population follow, you know, does the population of the school-age kids follow along with the population growth in other areas? Or I'm guessing it would. Do you understand my question?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. So yes, for the most part, as I said, our school-age population is declining throughout on the state overall, but yes, in those areas where we're seeing growth, you'll see some growth in that population as well.
Okay, now that's...
And the same goes for the racial and ethnic diversity as well. So we have some school systems where we're seeing large increases in the number of Asian students or Hispanic students.
So while Pennsylvania is a slow growth state, some of the areas are not experiencing slow growth.
Correct.
Right, okay, thanks.
Thank you, Representative Daley. And just, sorry, I didn't give one of the disclaimers before, and I appreciate Representative Daley's question. If we can, members, if we can keep our questions less of the essay-type statements with a little question at the very end, and you did a great job. I'm not that was a template for how to actually ask a question. But sometimes we have a tendency to ask these, like, 10-minute questions that really aren't questions. And we all know what I'm talking about. If we can just try to keep them concise. Representative Rabb.
Thank you. I was born in a log cabin and... No.
Great.
My question is, can you disaggregate some of those growth patterns within different ethnicities? For instance, Latino and Asian?
So the Asian population increases we'll see in the southeastern part of the state, and also in some of our university counties, you'll see that as well. And that's another point that you'll see if you look at the maps that we provided. Some of those growth pockets are also in the counties that have some of our state universities. So we see a lot of diversity there. And the Hispanic population is growing in southeast, south central, and some parts of the northeastern state. So Luzerne County, Lackawanna County, we've seen some growth in the Hispanic populations there as well.
Okay. Let me be more specific. Can you disaggregate by ethnicity within those races? So,
oh, yes.
You know, some states, there's a large percentage of Mexican Americans versus Puerto Rican or et cetera. Can you tell us a little bit about the flavor of our demography?
We can give that information to you. I don't know it right off the top of my head, but if you want, we could provide that information for you, a breakdown by the different types of Hispanic populations. Would that be okay?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Representative. Representative Keller.
Thank you, and thank you for your testimony. Just a couple things. I noticed you do some estimations in here. Do you do that yourself, or do you do that in concert with any other agencies?
The population estimates are from the U.S. Census Bureau.
Okay.
And the population projections we do produce at the State Data Center.
How accurate over time have our estimates been, you know, looking forward? Pretty accurate. I mean, I'm not looking for an exact thing, but they've been reasonably accurate.
Estimates?
Yes.
They are pretty accurate. I think last decade, I don't think we were off too much. Maybe like a couple percent.
Okay, yeah. So they're in other words, I'm just as decision makers, you know, I found your information because I use your website quite a bit,
okay,
and
good,
I found it to be pretty accurate. But I just want to make sure my understanding.
Yes, and the Census Bureau has over the years improved the methodology of what they're doing. In the estimates program, they're using more administrative data, so they have more detailed information at the person level that they can trend forward and backwards. So.
Okay. Just a couple other questions. You mentioned that the school age population, that's referenced in your testimony and in the materials. What age group is that?
5 to 19.
5 to 19. So yes. That would be people that would be in our public school system?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I noticed also, and I know you referenced 2010, we've seen a decline, but on slide, I guess it would be around slide number 8, it shows a decline since the year 2000. Is that, am I reading that properly?
I believe, is that the school age population?
Change in school age population.
Yeah.
Over that period of time. So that's declined. What age group do we believe has increased? You know, because our total population has either stayed where it should be or grown a little bit. Do we know what age category? I mean, I would assume it's probably the over 55, but
the 65 and older, and then the 45 to 54.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Cohort is growing.
Thank you very much. Appreciate that.
Thank you, Representative Keller. Representative Bloom.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a quick question on trends. We can look at these and we see some things. We see the beginning of a decrease in population in 2016 for the state. Are there any, I guess, leading indicators that you could maybe point out to us that you think these trends that we're seeing are going to hold true, or if there's any major shift taking place? Because as we try to look at long-term tax policy, I guess, is there any heads up you can give us to any surprises maybe that we might not see just from looking at the trend lines here that you've given us?
I always say for the population change, while the estimate showed a decrease for 2016, as you can see over time for the decade, we are, as like Jen mentioned, we are seeing slow growth. We're expecting that decline in 2016 to maybe make a turn. So by the time we get to 2020, we'll see an overall population increase. So we have actually increased in population since 2010. It's just when you're doing the estimates, you're seeing a slight decrease from one year to the other. And I'm going to put a plug in for Census 2020. So this is the time, and for LUCA. So this is the time. One of the biggest things that you can do at this point in time is get your municipalities to participate in the LUCA program, which is local update of census addresses, because that's what's going to run the census. So if we have a good base, a good address list for the census to go out and do the job of counting people, we'll be much better off. And I think they did that last in 2010. Philadelphia really, really pushed to make sure they had accurate addresses. They put a lot of effort into making sure everyone was counted. And as you can see, the population increased for the first time in 50 years. So it's very important that this is the time of the decade that you get your communities involved in the LUCA program and get the word out that census is coming, because that's what's going to run the population, and that's what's going to determine what we're going to have in 2020. We don't want to miss anyone. We figured out, was it about $2,900? $2,900 a year?
$2,900 per person.
Per year.
Per year.
That if you miss one person, that you're getting in federal money. That's a lot of money when you figure out,
Thank you.
Your community. Thank you for us allowing us to do that plug.
Representative Dean.
Thank you. And to both chairmen, sorry I was delayed in getting here. I represent Abington and Upper Dublin, so I'm home to Penn State Abington. So thanks for your information today. My question, and I apologize if you talked about it before I got in here, is about millennials. Where are the millennials in Pennsylvania? When they come to us, for example, for education, where do they go? What is our growth or retention rate or attraction for millennials?
Always been a something that's like important, because we do get a lot of students that come into the state for the universities. What we find is that a lot of times they'll leave right after graduation, but then they'll come back to the state, don't we? And then they'll move, like right after they retire, they might move back out of the state. And then they come back again in their older years. So while you do see a decrease, we usually see a tendency for an increase, like Jen was mentioning in that, was it 35 age group. So they'll go out and then they'll come back in.
And is there any data in this report or data you could share with us about the trends with millennials?
Sure. It's not included in that report, but yes, we do have some information that we can share with the committee.
That'd be great. Thank you very much.
And the only other thing I'll add there is when we do see movement out of the state, for the most part, students who come to the state, we do see predominantly they will move to border states, which, as we can expect.
Sure. Thank you very much.
That is very good information. Thank you, Representative Dean. Representative Kaur.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for testifying today. I wanted to follow up on some of the questions that were asked about the school-age population. Do you have data on the 0 to 5-year-olds and where we're going with them and where we are presently?
Yes. One of the things that we do at the data center, while we use the estimates from the Census Bureau, we do create a single year of age estimate file for the Department of Health for the 0 to 19, so we can provide that information.
And do you have any information as you sit here today as to what the trends are for 0 to 5? I mean, we're seeing declines in school age population. I'm trying to get a sense of what the next few years we should expect.
The 0 to 5 age group is pretty stable. But we have seen just recently, for a short period of time, the births in the state were declining. Just within the past 2 years, that has made a turn. So the births are now flat. We're no longer seeing a decline. We're not seeing a significant increase, but it is flattening. So we expect that there will be stability in that 0 to 5 age group, if not a slight increase, now that the births have flattened.
Thank you very much for that. Let me shift gears just for one other question. You mentioned the growth in population in Southeast and South Central. Do you know if those are, is that internal growth, people moving within Pennsylvania, or are these new Pennsylvanians coming in?
Both. And those moving in, again, I will state, are predominantly from our bordering states. We're not getting people coming, you know, from the Midwest or from California. It's the bordering states. But there is a lot of movement within, especially the South Central Pennsylvania area.
What is the age demographic of that new population?
I would have to get you more specifics, but in general, I would say a lot of that movement is among the working age population.
Okay. Do you know, sticking with that, do you know one of the things we think about a lot is the retention of the college age? I think Representative Dean may have been touching on this too, the millennial age. Do we have that data as to how well we retain that age group within the state?
We haven't looked at it specifically, I would say, within the past five years or so. We have done reports over the previous decades and previous time periods on that. We can share that. And it is something, that we can get some more detailed data on. We just didn't include it.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Representative Kaur. I'd like to also recognize the Democratic Chair, Representative Wheatley, who's hiding in the back. He's certainly welcome to join us up here if he so chooses. But just a very quick question from Representative Daly, and then I just have two very quick questions.
Actually, in the interest of time, I'll pass in the questions and I'll send them directly to you. Thanks.
Perfect. Thank you, Representative Daly. Representative Kaur kind of hit on question number one for me, which is what is driving? I mean, we talked about some trends. What is driving the trends, right? So, is it deaths? Is it births? Is it moving? Is it migration? If you can just speak to that a little bit, because, you know, as we talked about earlier, you know, you can say the population is getting older, but practically, what does that mean? Are there just fewer young people, or are there older people migrating in to Pennsylvania? Is it both? Is it young people moving out and older people moving in? Is it the lack of school age children, just the people aren't having kids, or is it that the younger working families are moving out of Pennsylvania? If you can just talk to that a little bit, to add a little granularity.
Okay, I can start with, so as I mentioned, the births are fairly flat. And deaths are increasing because we do have a large older population. We are, though, seeing an steady or increasing number of migrants. So that is exactly what is driving, as you mentioned, the population change is migration, because our natural increase, births minus deaths, is fairly flat and has been over time. So people are having fewer children as well, and women are having children later, as we can see in the birth statistics. As far as older people moving into the state, the only thing we can speak of is back to the comment that Sue made earlier, that we do see oftentimes as people begin their retirement, they may move out of the state, but then as they get older, they return. So that we do see as an overarching trend. Did that answer all of your questions?
I appreciate that answer. The second question is, if we look at, you had mentioned that Pennsylvania is losing those residents that are moving out of the state to border states. Would those border states include Virginia, or would it stop with Maryland and West Virginia, Ohio, New York, and New Jersey, and Delaware?
No, it would include Virginia, but the
So how far west and south would that go?
It goes south, I would say, even into North Carolina. Would you agree?
Yes.
And west, I'm not sure I can answer that without getting you some more detail. But the largest flows that we see are to New York, New Jersey, Maryland.
Okay, that's if we can get any available information on what those competing states are, where are we losing population to? You know, it's easy for lawmakers to talk about, you know, policy in California and policy in Texas and Florida, but the reality is that Pennsylvania isn't necessarily directly competing with those states. However, we would be necessarily competing with Wisconsin south to Missouri, east to South Carolina, would be my guess. And so if we can get some additional information about the population flow between those states, I think that would probably be beneficial.
Absolutely.
With no other questions, I want to thank you for your testimony and your candor this morning and your willingness to be available for follow-up questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, we're just slightly over our schedule, but if I can have Dr. Strauss, please come up if you are prepared, sir, and you can jump right into your testimony. Full disclaimer, I believe that Dr. Strauss is a constituent of mine.
Long time.
Well, I've only been in it for 7 years, so it couldn't have been that long, but while he's getting prepared.
Yeah, I have been asked to do something short, so I took an envelope and put my 6 key points on it. And what I want to do is bring up the file.
If we can, while Dr. Strauss is getting ready, we were joined by Representative Kaur and Dean, whom we've heard from, but if they would like to introduce themselves very briefly.
So,
thank you. My name is Michael Kaur. I represent the 150th Legislative District, which is located in Montgomery County.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Madeline Dean. I represent the 153rd in Montgomery County, also Abington, Upper Dublin.
Thank you. Have we killed enough of the clock?
Okay, in 5 minutes or less, thank you for inviting me. Thank you for endorsing my efforts years ago with a House resolution, which surprised me. Dan Hassel, my former student, alerted me that the Pennsylvania House was glad for my advice on taxing the internet. Whether Congress will do that, who knows? I've got 6 points. The first one that I want to make to you is to think about not addressing constitutional issues like the uniformity clause. And in particular, I want to report to you, and it's in my testimony, that attempts to go to a progressive rate structure have failed at least a dozen times over the centuries. And so that, if you agree with that suggestion, that already begins to define the kinds of tax policies for the future that you might recommend to the Commonwealth. Second, I am less impressed with arguments by local governments that because we are a Commonwealth, they should be left alone to their own devices. As a professor and a parent of three grown children, my wife and I, we're not overly strict, but I think you have the authority through the power of the purse, if nothing else, to get folks to come along. If you read my biography, I've been involved at the national level years ago in transactional federalism, revenue sharing, and got governments, state and local, to do things they might not otherwise do because they wanted money. And so I think you have the authority to overcome some of the complaints that because we're a commonwealth, school districts and counties, et cetera, should be left to their own devices, but they still want your money. Slide six shows the history of rates. Let's see if I can. So this is the most recent past, and it's a good news, bad news story. The good news is the declining curve is when you got rid of the capital stock and franchise tax. And that was something in 1981 when I directed the Thornburg-Sired Tax Commission. We were anxious to at least clarify the fixed formula, if not get rid of it. There were a lot of successes and some things that are still on the agenda. In my written remarks, I go through some of them, but you might want to think about outstanding issues with nuisance taxes and the availability of revenues at the local level to match the responsibilities, especially for county governments through human services. They are, other than Allegheny and Philadelphia, in a pickle. So you can see that the sales tax has been flat at 6%, and that when you've needed revenues, you've gone to the corporate net income tax, and it's at 9.99%. That's a noticeable impediment around the country when people look at us. I can tell you how to plan it and get around it, but the reality is we're in the charts way out there. The personal income tax has inched up over time. And my next message to you is that if you look at the base, you've really given away a lot of money over time. So look at these numbers. I went through the tax expenditure budget for three periods, the 90s, 15, 16, and then the projection that are in the governor's budget. I assume everybody knows that giving up through credits, deductions, exemptions, you're giving up what otherwise could be done through the spending side of the budget. But I did something that was tedious all by myself. I added it up. And so in 94-95, the tax expenditures in total were $20.7 billion, or 107% of the general fund. And if you look at 15-16, it was 105% of the general fund. And if you look at the projections in the latest budget, it's $54 billion foregone through exemptions, credits, and non-neutralities. And that's 134% of the projected general fund. That's real money, and I have lots of ideas and opinions about what you might want to think about, but the demography of our state is part of the cause of it. So let me give you some numbers that are in a paper I gave a couple years ago that are a little bit more stunning than what the folks from the data center said. By 2025, we will have added to the composition of our population, a million more elderly and lost a million prime age workers. So with a stagnant population, you basically changed from a productive population to one increasingly dependent, okay? And that turns out to be, if you project what healthcare costs and the other costs in the budget for the elderly are, which are not uniformly reported, it's a very big deal. Okay, so this is from a paper I did a couple years ago at Lehigh, and what it shows is that the service outlays for the elderly on budget and off budget, depending on how you count things, was about $4.2 to $4.7 billion. The tax expenditures, by not taxing private or public retirement income, you forewent for $2.5 billion. But by 2025, using sort of central projections of what the elderly are going to be and what they're going to need in terms of health care costs, you're spending between $5.8 and $7.8 billion for the elderly, and you're giving up by not taxing retirement income between $5.4 and $7 billion. So that's the story that I'd like you to ponder. And I'm well aware that I'm part of the seniors population. I think I'm undertaxed. There may be some folks with some gray I'm looking across. My wife is very angry. You know, she doesn't want to tax the elderly. She thinks they should continue to be treated nicely. But the reality is, given the demographic changes, it doesn't add up. And if anything, we're going to have migration. It's going to be from seniors coming from New York and New Jersey across the border into the Lehigh Valley because they get a very good deal here, okay? So unless you are going to cut your human services to people in their 70s and 80s who are extremely expensive and we're living a lot longer, you really have to think about aligning the service costs by taxing those who in retirement can afford to pay. And you have the constitutional authority to do that. You can tax more lightly retirement income. I know that this doesn't sound like a winning proposition for somebody running for re-election, but let me give you another number. I read the IOF report and I thought they were optimistic. They saw our population growing. And what I'm trying to tell you is people are talking with their feet now, okay? That's what's happening here. And if you want to see indications, look at new incorporations, business starts, the employment rate, median income. Everything is very sluggish, okay? So I really think that the tax expenditures are where you can find a way to reasonably finance our future. And the last thing I want to talk about, and it's been a problem in the state forever, is the situation with real estate assessments. So you're probably aware, because you pay them and you know that your neighbor doesn't quite pay the same as you, that the variability in the assessments in Pennsylvania are quite high. Well, in my there's slides and in my written testimony, I show it county by county, the coefficient of dispersion. The International Assessors Association says that this dispersion coefficient should be either 15 or 20% for residential, 20% overall. When I do the numbers, I get 99%, okay? And bigger is worse. So if I ask myself, why did people vote the way they did last week? It's because they know that their neighbor's not paying what they are or vice versa. Another aspect of the assessment issue has to do with, if you really foresee the future in terms of the state budget, there's going to be issues about what local government should be doing. And my thought is that you should think about giving them the tools so that they can finance the local services that you want them to pay for, because you're not going to have the wherewithal at the state level. And you're talking then about getting the property tax on a reasonable basis. And I would also argue that that's an economic development issue, okay? Because companies looking to come into Pennsylvania, when they look at coefficients of dispersion of 99%, know that unless they get a complete exemption, they don't know what, they're playing Russian roulette. And if you wind up saying that homestead should be exempt across the state, and the property tax is how local government is going to finance itself, well, the only other piece is either agricultural or business. I got news for you. You can't repeal the law of mathematics all the time. So there are issues in our structure out there in getting some of the administrative issues addressed finally that I think are well worth your consideration. I could go on for days. I'm not a lawyer, but I get paid to speak because I teach. But let me stop at this point. I hope I've woken you up, and maybe you can challenge some of my statements.
Thank you, Dr. Strauss. You know, give a guy a captive audience and a microphone, right? I can do wonders. Now, your testimony was very enlightening. I do want to I do want to pass things off for questions here. But before I do that, I just want to ask a very brief question. My understanding of Pennsylvania's taxes are that they're primarily driven by available disposable income and income, correct? Sales tax and income tax, the bulk of our taxes.
At the state level.
At the state level.
Yeah.
How would you describe the tax and spend situation in Pennsylvania if we're talking about increasing rates in order to pay for our state budgets? And this wraps into some of what you said about human services. If we have to increase tax rates in order to pay for our state budget, what does that say about the relative relationship between those who are paying taxes and those who are accepting tax money? And when I say those, I'm referring to the organizations that are paid, not people.
Right. So what you've done, the graph that shows the rates, sometimes you brought them down when things got better. But if you accept the uniformity clause and accept the fact you've got a proportional tax system, either on sales, consumption, or on income, business income or individual income, you've got to figure out how you're going to get control over spending, because the elderly cost more and it grows proportionately more. And if you are driven to redistribute more, you're going to find that you just don't have the money. And that's really the problem you've been facing the last couple of years. You're short of money, and where you've tried to encourage certain behavior, you've narrowed the base. So I guess, Mr. Chairman, what I would say is, if you're going to try to grapple with the future, an older population, you've got to be far more vigilant and creative on the spending side through voluntary and not necessarily budget-driven kinds of service delivery systems. The federal government's encouraged this, too. I mean, you can't afford to go to nursing homes, okay? If you do the math, a nursing home costs $100,000 a year. If there's 1 million more people and you put them in a nursing home, it's going to blow up your calculator. So you really have to start thinking very creatively about how are you going to incentivize nonprofits, volunteer organizations to provide services. Second of all, there are compositional effects within the school age population, and I would encourage you to look at that and make sure that the school districts have flexibility, because the high schools have lost about 50, 60,000 kids. They're a lot more expensive. So there are things on the spending side that I would really encourage you to think about, and it's painful, because I have worked for Congress, and I've tried to help state legislators and mayors, and everybody wants to provide services to their constituents. But when the base isn't growing very much and the demands for the services are there and they're also reflected through votes, you find yourself in a pickle. So I really think that rather than trying to increase rates, I mean, I've heard that the PIT is on the drawing boards for 19, but if you don't solve this problem by getting the tax expenditures for the elderly partially back into the base, you're just going to be shooting yourself in the foot.
Thank you, Dr. Stress. I'd like to recognize Representative Wheatley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate you allowing me to ask a few questions. Thank you, Dr. Strauss, for being here. I wanted to kind of get your thoughts. If we stop for a minute as a government and asked a question around, where do we want to be 5, 10, or 20 years from now? Not look at what are our challenges today, but to think about where we want to go tomorrow. And then the second question to that is, how do we get there from a tax structure as well as an investment structure? And then the final question becomes, where do we take from where we are now to get to where we say we want to be 5 or 10 or 20 years ago, which is what I would like for us to do instead of what we typically do, is try to manage the challenges of the decline today. So I appreciate when you talk about the growing issue of our senior population.
But in fact, if we want to increase our base and we think we have some advantages competitively, either technology-wise or higher institution or higher ed institutions or healthcare or whatever, and we think we can make the right investments for those, then aren't we also thinking that we will increase the base of population? So instead of making decisions around how we currently manage what we have, we're making decisions based off of what we want to kind of become. And then the strategy shifts. So if you were at a table with us, which you are today, and you were helping us to kind of think through that question or those series of questions, where would you say we should begin from our from a financing perspective?
I think what you're saying is that you want to make Pennsylvania a more attractive place that will get people to stay, have us be higher up on various lists of where companies want to come, people want to move to, because we have natural attractions, and that our state and local governments care about our communities and our people to make things work better. It's not just a KYZ zone, I'll tell you. It might have been a good idea, but there are places in the United States. I started my career at Chapel Hill, and I watched the Triangle grow. That was a very long-term and visionary thing done by some private and public folks, saying, okay, if we can get a couple of major companies to go into the Triangle between Raleigh, Durham, and Chapel Hill, and we can provide the infrastructure, will it begin to take hold? And the answer is that the patience worked. We're a big, diverse state. I'm in the western part. Southeast has got a whole different set of politics and views. But there needs to be, across the caucuses and in the governor's office, a common vision, an agreed-upon set of principles about what we want to accomplish in terms of a place to live, a place to work. And that, upon being embraced, involves agreement on a strategic plan, okay? Politics, balancing the budget, is the antithesis of that, I understand. But there are a bunch of things that you can do. Look, the IOF is a relatively new institution. You can invest in it some of these longer-term responsibilities. Discussing demography is a relatively new thing for the General Assembly. Some states have state demographers because they understand it's really important. But for you as elected representatives, both here in the House and the Senate, and the governor to say, we are going to have some long-term goals, and these are shared values, might not lead to immediate legislation. But believe me, stating that is a step forward, and it's a statement that we know what we want our future to be. Now, as I said in my written testimony, there was a time when Pennsylvania was 11% of the U.S. population. That was 1790. We're down around 4% now. And most companies in this state and most people can't set prices or wages the way we once did when the unions controlled the workshop and U.S. Steel controlled the market for steel. We're inherently facing a much more competitive environment among the states and internationally. And so being clever about things like communication, transportation, thinking about carefully what our natural advantages are ways to begin a dialogue. We have foundation communities in both the East and the West who can help promote this. But it's gonna take a different kind of conversation while you work through the immediate challenges. But I think if you get the politics together on an agreement on long run, you can actually make progress, because then people get forced into saying, well, if you want to be here, then how are we going to get there, which is your point. But first there's got to be agreement, okay? And that's not so easy.
Thank you. just want to remind the members we're pushing our schedule a little bit here, and we want to respect the other testifiers' time. So if we can try to be as brief as we can in our questions and answers. Representative Rabb? Thank you. Representative Dean?
Thank you, Professor, and your testimony, for me, provides a long list of questions, but I'll try to focus on two areas, if I may. So
I'll give you a cell phone number, Representative Dean. He certainly doesn't hesitate using mine.
Oh, there you go. If you could go back to the screen you began with, which was figure three, and the history of PA major tax rates, 72 to 17.
This one. Okay.
That's it.
Yep.
And I sit on this committee, and I also sit on the Appropriations Committee. So, and all of us struggle through the budget process in ugly ways. What does that screen tell you that you can tell me about what would be a healthy mix of revenue streams for Pennsylvania?
Okay. Well, I'm happy that the sales and use tax at the state level has been constant, because I think people and businesses like certainty over what the rates are going to be. It allows them to plan, okay? My older friends get mad at me when I say let's tax retirement income because they're retired, and they say they didn't plan. So my response is, so you phase it in. I can tell you stories for hours about what I heard when I moved into Pennsylvania in 79, when Westinghouse got really furious at the gyrations of the corporate net income tax, and promises were made and promises were broken, and 12% was the rule of the day. So I think in many respects you've got to think about revenue-driven tax rates and addressing the tax bases in these tax expenditures rather than fussing around with the rates. Okay? Clothing, if you put it in the sales tax base, according to Department of Revenue, it would bring in about $800 million. And when I've looked at the distributional tables, it's progressive, okay? What's not in the base now in terms of clothing, putting it in would be progressive, okay? So from both sides of the aisle, $800 million a year would have made a hell of a difference, right? Okay, and it would be persistent, predictable. So that's the other piece of as you're planning into the future. What you want to tell everybody, including yourselves, is that with a rate structure and a base structure, you can meet your spending obligations on a reasonable basis and start to fill up the recession fund, which is apparently dry at this point. Okay, so you can do some fiscal planning. You got rid of the capital stock and franchise. Those were tough votes. Okay. But, you know, I think you would be much better advised to look at the base of the PIT than say, well, we're going to go to 4% or something. I just think you're asking for trouble.
Could you explain that again? Look at the base of the PIT versus
trying to raise the rate so that you have some predictable revenues in the future.
I have a notion that I've floated, and I admit that it is simplistic, but I wanted to just bounce it off you. What if we were to reduce sales tax by 1 point, increase PIT by 1 point? Increasing PIT would bring in roughly $4 billion. Decreasing sales tax would return about $1.6 billion to pockets and consumers. There'd be an increased level of recurring revenue, as I said, and I think also the money returned in buying power, I think, would be regenerated into the economy. What do you think of a notion like that?
I'm uncomfortable lowering this anymore. If you ever thought you were, you just don't have degrees of freedom anymore.
And we couldn't raise it 0.1%, so I get that it would be noticed.
Listen, I opined and think about broadening the base of the PIT and not raising the rate, and then making sure on the spending side you actually pay attention. See, this thing about bringing in the money so that you don't have to float debt is fine and good, but there's also a value proposition that needs to be addressed, which is, given what we're going to be paying, are we meeting the service requirements that we wish and take care of those who are not able to take care of themselves? And are we doing it in a humane and efficient manner? And I could go on for days about what you ought to do in public education, but that's not the purpose of this hearing. There's plenty of places to manage better than you're managing. It's hard work. It's unpleasant finding out about the facts of what the Commonwealth folks at the local level are really doing. But I know what I see, and I know what I see in the city of Pittsburgh. So let me
Thank you, Dr. Strauss. Yeah.
Thank you, Chairman. Yeah. I would like to talk to you. I won't take your cell phone because I don't think that's polite.
I respond to all email.
Representative Daly.
Thank you. I was glad to see that you brought up the assessment issue. And I just, for the members of this committee at the Local Government Commission, which is bipartisan and bicameral, is has a working group right now on the assessment process in Pennsylvania. And be interested in just, so I appreciate the information you gave us related to the coefficient of dispersal and all that. I do have a question related to that, which is a very quick question. On your table 1.3, where you have the common level ratio, the sales, the median, the coefficient of dispersion, there's a huge difference between when you take off the top and bottom of the ratios from 5% to 10%.
Right.
So, like, my county goes from 74.8% to 20.7%, which is almost where it should be. So,
right. So what's going on? So what's going on is that STEB doesn't get much in the way of sales transaction data from rural counties. And they're not, the data is provided to STEB on a voluntary basis. And that means that some counties will say that something cost a dollar or zero, and STEB is forced to treat that as real data. 25% of the transactions in 2015 were for a dollar or less. And so you can't come up with measures of dispersion on such faulty data. Let me give you a number that I forgot to mention. On average, Pennsylvania assessors spend $11 per parcel, and that's about half of the national average. So if you ask the question, why are the assessments so out of whack, the answer is that they're not required to be in whack, number one, and number two, there's no money being spent except when there's a court-ordered reassessment, like in Indiana County, which Mr. Reed knows very well.
So I think we may be making some good steps in just looking at some of these underlying issues. So I'm hoping that when it comes time to voting for these bills, that we can get support from this group so that they can understand how important that whole process is. So this is really helpful information, so thank you.
Thank you, Representative Daly. Representative Bloom, very briefly.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Doctor, if you look at your figure 2 and figure 3, it's on page 8 of the written materials, one thing I noticed right away when I looked at that is it appears that, just as a general proposition, that in that first 1926 and 1971 period, the rates were just generally much lower proposition.
So the short answer is Pennsylvania was a dominant part of the Industrial Revolution, and we were growing. And when you're growing, there's money to be taxed and money to spend.
And the question I had, though, is, and then you look at it later, obviously they're much higher. I was going to ask you, relative to the other states, the states we talked about earlier in the hearing that are kind of the competing states where our population either ebbs or flows toward or away from, is their history similar to this? And can you talk about that you hit on in the previous answer to another question, the fact that we can't change our tax structure in a vacuum? What we do will obviously be viewed by the general populace in terms of what would the rates be in other states, especially states around us. Thank you.
So let me just focus on the sales and use tax, because a friend of mine at Bloomington did a very interesting study, and I reported in my written remarks. We collect for each percentage point about $150 per capita in sales and use tax collections. And if you compare us to other states, Representative, as Eli said, Ohio and so forth, they're getting 175, 180. And so there's, what's going on there is two things. Their incomes are a little bit higher, so people are consuming at a higher level, but their bases are broader, okay? So I'm not sure everybody here appreciates that when I tell you the tax expenditures are the same size as the general fund, you've given away a lot of things. And so that means you've narrowed the base, be it the PIT or the sales and use tax, compared to other states. And I can't give you an exact answer, for everything. But, you know, in the exclusion of retirement income, we're one of only four states in the country. And everybody else somehow taxes some of retirement income. I know it's the forbidden fruit, but that's just the fact. So there was a time when it was given away. And I know in 91 it was put back on the base. And the Great Panthers came here, and everybody got scared. And so it got thrown out of the base. But you can put things into the base slowly so that people who made a plan 10 or 15 years don't get bitten badly, okay? But I think what you're going to see is that you've narrowed your bases, and so you're now faced with the dilemma, do you want to raise rates or not? And raising rates is very visible around the country. So I think you need to get out the calculators and the pencils and make Dan and his staff work hard.
Dr. Strauss, thank you. And I know that the Secretary is willing to put up with our going along on the schedule because of our mutual respect for you. So I appreciate your patience. I have two questions. You can answer them via email. If there are short answers here, that'd be great. But question number one, the easy one, is why do we not tax retirement income in Pennsylvania? Are you aware of the decision point for when that happened?
Okay, so 91 was a very bad year in terms of the economy, and it was a very contentious sort of a budget. And so retirement income had been excluded, and it was excluded for a long time. But in 91, it was put back in. David Sweet, who was a member of the House for a long time, educated me that was in, and people voted it in, and then all hell broke loose, okay? But the argument is a very simple moral argument that my wife gives me, that if you care about seniors who are no longer able to work, then you should more favorably treat their retirement income. It's, you know, why Social Security is, you know, partially not taxed by the federal government, so forth. So I think the philosophic issue is the same as why a widow gets her deceased spouse's assets, because she doesn't have the wherewithal on a farm or whatever to produce and support herself. So that's the same. But we're living longer, too, you know. So it's not quite the same argument as 30 years ago.
That's almost the same answer that one of my favorite answers I get when I was at U.S. Steel, which was it's kind of just always been done that way.
Yeah.
Obviously some equity there, but I think something worthwhile to look at. And the last question, and I think that maybe this would be a good question to answer offline, but that would be, given our spending growth, the growth of our spending as relative to the growth of our economy, as you outlined in your answer to my first question, which was, you know, if we're making more, if our taxes are tied to that, then we should always have a surplus of revenue over expenditures if expenditures aren't growing at a similar rate or higher rate. But given the fact that we do find ourselves in this perpetual cycle of revenues are not growing as fast as our expenditures, which means that income and disposable income is not growing as fast as our expenditures, if we were as a state to expand the base in the sales tax or expand the base in the PIT, what would your estimation, what would your estimate be for when the lines would cross again? In other words, so we'd have this glut of new revenue, but given the fact that our relative percentage increase in expenditures is outpacing the growth of incomes and the growth of disposable incomes, regardless of what that base expansion looks like, at some point those lines are going to cross one another again, and we're going to be back in the position we are today. Okay. So the question is, when would you see that happening?
All right, my calculation a couple of years ago was looking at 2025, that if you put retirement income in the base, and I made projections of spending on the elderly, that you could self-finance that part of the budget. Whereas if you don't, you're going to be in a $7 to $8 billion hole. So that's what that table means. Okay, now I'm not going to bet my retirement on it, but I think that's the way to think about it.
Thank you, Dr. Strasser. We appreciate your time. Moving right along, and my apologies for the delay in the schedule, I'd like to call the Secretary of Revenue, Dan Hassel, and Deputy Secretary Amy Gill. When you're ready.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and committee. Thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today. We have submitted written testimony for you to consider, but I'm not going to read that into the record today. What we would like to do is to direct your attention to the charts that are at the back of our testimony. There are six charts, and the purpose is simply for us to talk about trends in general fund collections, the major revenue sources, what's growing and what's not growing, and the reasons for those kinds of changes. I'm going to get us started, and then I'm going to turn it over to Amy Gill to take over at some point. So in this first chart, we have two pie charts, and I should say at the outset that in all of these charts that we prepared, this is looking at general fund tax revenue. In other words, it excludes anything that's non-tax revenue. Fund transfers, fees, fines, interest, all those kinds of things are excluded because they're very volatile. This is a comparison of general fund revenue, tax revenue, over a 20-year period. In 96-97, general fund tax revenue was $17 billion. In this most recently completed year of 16-17, that grew to $30.8 billion, which is growing by 80% over that time period. But the composition of those taxes has shifted. Sales tax revenue is a smaller share of the general fund. It fell from 36% to 33%. And at the same time, personal income tax revenue has grown in its share from 34 to 41. Revenue from corporation taxes has fallen significantly during this period. The major corporate taxes that are shown here, corporate and income tax, capital stock and franchise tax, and gross receipts tax, were 20% of the general fund 20 years ago. They're now 13% of the total, and that primarily it's due to the elimination of the capital stock tax, as we've already talked about here today. So overall, 74% of the general fund collections are from two taxes, PIT and sales tax, and that figure is up from 70% 20 years ago. So if we flip to the second chart, then we're pulling the data apart so you can see the trend lines in the major revenue sources. This chart is looking at changes from the 06-07 tax year and allows you to see what's growing and what's declining. Over this 10-year period, the increase in tax revenue was about $4 billion, which is about 15%. The line at the top of this chart says personal income 2403. So personal income tax has gone up by $2.4 billion over this time period. And the line below it is sales tax, which grew by $1.4 billion. There's a group in the middle that represents cigarette tax, corporate income, and gross receipts tax. Those are things that are growing growing more slowly. Cigarette tax in particular is interesting because revenue is up by almost $500 million over this 10-year period, but that's entirely due to two rate increases that occurred. The rate was $1.35 per pack, and it's currently $2.60 per pack. And if we adjust for the tax rate changes, the cigarette tax base is now 30% smaller than it was 10 years ago. Corporate income tax grew by $259 million during these 10 years. For most of these years, C&I revenues were below the 06-07 level and only recently showed a small amount of revenue growth. Gross receipts tax has been stagnant over this entire period, with only slight increases and decreases from one year to the next. Gross receipts tax revenue comes primarily from two things, a tax on electricity and a tax on telecommunications. There's been very little growth in the electricity business, and in telecommunications, it's actually been in decline. And that's primarily a result of the shift in the telephone business from landlines to cell phones that have data plans where the data usage is exempt from tax under federal law. Offsetting much of the growth in the other revenues, capital stock tax has been phased down gradually to zero from almost $1 billion 10 years ago due to the elimination of the tax, and that is the red line that falls all the way to the bottom in this chart. So I'd like to turn it over to Amy at this point to talk some more detail about the growth of these revenue sources.
Yes, the next series of chart will show index growth of taxes compared to economic variables. When you index both sets of figures, you start at the same starting point, in this case, 97-98, and then the lines will show the growth from that point forward. When you look at chart 3, titled Total Tax Revenue versus PA Personal Income, you can see that total tax revenue is a declining share of PA personal income. There have been variations over time with higher revenue during strong economic times and drop-offs during recession periods. In fiscal year 16-17, general fund tax revenue was at its lowest share of personal income during this 20-year period. Chart 4 tracks PIT revenue versus PA personal income. They closely track over time. There are some years when the growth in PIT revenue is over or under the growth of personal income. The primary reason for that is fluctuations in capital gains income. Capital gains income is very volatile, and it has a significant effect on our PIT revenue, but it's not included in the measurement of personal income. Aside from this factor, you can see that PIT revenue follows the personal income very closely. The 2004 increase in the PIT rate from 2.8% to 3.07% is also a factor that raises the PIT revenue during this time period. When we turn to chart 5, which is titled sales tax revenue versus personal consumption expenditures, we see a different pattern for sales tax. Sales tax revenue lags PA personal consumption growth. This is partially due to the shifting pattern in personal consumption, as the growth in spending on services, which is generally not taxable, has outpaced that of spending on goods. In order to show the effect of the growth on services, the chart also shows a dotted line for personal consumption of goods, which is growing more slowly. However, sales tax revenue falls short of this measure as well. We believe that this is attributable in large measure to the growth of internet commerce, which escaped sales tax to some degree. If sales tax had taxed the personal consumption of goods for these 20 years, sales tax revenue would have been $1.2 billion higher in the last fiscal year. Finally, when we turn to chart 6, which is CNIT, corporate net income tax revenue versus corporate profits. Corporate profits, as you can see, are very volatile, growing strongly during good economic times and falling dramatically during the recessions. The chart makes it clear that CNIT revenue has not kept pace with national corporate profits. Growth begins to lag in the early 2000s and has never recovered. Indeed, if CNIT revenue had grown at the same rate as corporate profits, the department would have collected an additional $1.6 billion in CNIT in 16-17. The reasons for the lagging CNIT revenue include tax cuts enacted several times during this period. For fiscal year 6-7, the amount of tax foregone for the net operating loss deduction and an increased weight in the sales factor was 15% of collections. By 2016-17, that had increased to 38%. The NOL deduction was increased from a cap of $2 million in 2006 to the greater of $5 million, or 30% of income, in 2017. The percentage cap benefits a few hundred large corporations each year. The sales factor weight for apportionment was increased to 60% to 100% over the same time period. For these two expenditures alone, the NOL and the sales factor, the estimated tax foregone in 16-17 was more than $1 billion. I would also note that legislation reducing business taxes has been enacted with bipartisan support across several administrations, including that of Governor Wolf, to reduce the business tax burden and increase the competitiveness of the Commonwealth. We raise these issues simply to help explain the slow growth of revenues over a long period of time and that they have had a significant budgetary cost. In addition, the rapid growth in tax credits is also a factor in lower CNIT revenue. In 15-16, there were a total of 16 tax credit programs with awards of more than $383 million. Most of these awards were eventually lower CNIT payments. Finally, there are additional 13 tax credits that were not awarded in 15-16 but have begun since. So 17% of the general fund tax collections are imposed on tax bases that are stagnant or even declining: the cigarette tax, the gross receipts tax, and the corporate net income tax. In addition, sales tax receipts, which are 33% of the tax collections, are not keeping up with personal consumption due to shifting purchase patterns. So in summary, I have a few final points for you to remember. 74% of general fund tax collections are from two taxes, the PIT and the sales and use tax. The strongest source of revenue growth is from the PIT. Personal consumption is increasing faster for services, which limits sales tax growth. The expansion of the internet commerce has also had an impact on sales tax. Legislative changes to the corporate net income tax reduced revenue by an estimated $1 billion in 16-17. The tax credit and zone programs have also expanded rapidly, most of which offset CNIT. And then the phase-out of the capital stock and franchise tax has offset other sources of revenue growth by almost $1 billion. 17% of the general fund tax collections are imposed on tax bases that are stagnant or declining. So thank you for the opportunity to provide this information.
Thank you. We're going to move on to questions. Thank you for your testimony. I just have one very brief point to make, and that is on the NOL carry forward. Just so that everyone's on the same page, with the NOL, there was a 30% cap and a $5 million, which the greater of the two. The $5 million cap was recently found to be unconstitutional. So there is just the percentage threshold, which I believe under the current budget enactment will go to 40%. I think, which will represent a net tax increase of about $200 to $250 million on all corporations in Pennsylvania. If that rate would go up higher, get closer to a break-even point. But just so that we're all on the same page, that's kind of new news in the nerd tax world.
yes, Mr. Chairman, that's correct, and the department will be releasing guidance on that subject soon.
It's perfect. Just a brief question. You had mentioned, Ms. Gill, that the corporate profits were national numbers. Were those national?
Yes, we don't have a source for PA corporate profits.
Okay, so when we look at CNIT revenue in Pennsylvania, that's bumped up against growth of corporate profits nationwide. So that's companies that are reporting their income to the state of New York, the state of California. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure we understood that. So with questions, I recognize Representative Wheatley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good morning, Mr. Secretary and Madam Deputy Secretary. I have just two real quick questions. You pointed out in your testimony, and unless I misheard it, 74% of our tax structure comes from predominantly two taxes, and then 17% of our tax base or rate is associated to a staggering or a stagnant population or declining source. The first question is, in your opinion, is that a sustainable tax structure for what we are trying to accomplish in the future? And I guess that's a double-edged sword when there's not necessarily agreed to vision of the future, but under our current structure, if that's our tax rate and policy, is it sustainable?
Representative, that's a very good question, and the purpose for setting out this kind of data for the committee was to make you aware of the fact that we do have a significant percentage of the general fund that is from things that aren't growing, that are stagnant, and we know that the costs of providing services are growing. Professor Strauss talked about the aging of the population and the growing need for services there. So that certainly makes the that challenge much more difficult.
So in the face of that, and Mr. Chairman, if you will indulge me, in the face of that, I think it's really timely that the subcommittee is kind of tackling this question around where do we want to be 5 years, 10 years from now from our finance part of things. I mean, we certainly have a question around what we have to do in our spending side. But from our current tax policy, if we are going to be something different, then we need to have a different set of realities. So have you all as a department ways forward for us from a financing perspective? Or are you just simply enforcing whatever we pass, you're just going to enforce it and regulate that? You're not thinking as it relates to long-term viability or anything like that?
Yeah, the honest answer is that the department is charged with enforcing the law as it exists today. That's what we do day in and day out. I would be very happy to provide any information that the committee needs to do this difficult job of looking more long-term at the system and thinking about those issues strategically.
Representative Rabb.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Eli's fine, by the way.
Thank you, Eli. Can you tell me the what happened with the capital stock and franchise tax? Do you know the history behind when that was projections for what would happen if that were to have remained?
The capital stock tax has a very long history that goes way back into the 1800s. And to my knowledge, it hit a peak rate of 13 mils in the early 1990s. And since then, there has been through several governors of both parties in agreement that it would be best to phase that revenue source out. And the rate has been stepped down year by year. Sometimes the phase down was postponed temporarily, but then it started again. And it finally reached the point of being a zero rate in 2015.
If I could, just a quick follow-up. When we look at corporate profits in Pennsylvania, and we look at the diversification of kind of corporate entities, and we have LLCs, pass-through tax entities. What can you talk about in terms of the demography of corporations that that we tax, in terms of those things that are kind of stale and are shrinking, and those things that are representative of the most revenue generating? Does that make sense?
Let me take a stab at it. You can tell me if okay. I got it. Over the last, really the same time period of roughly 20 years, there has been a shift in the makeup of the business community. There are fewer C corporations than there used to be, and the business type of choice these days is an LLC or a limited partnership, some sort of pass-through entity or an S corporation. And that has been a tremendous change in the way that taxation works, both at the federal level and at the level of every state that taxes businesses, because pass-through entities are much more complex. They're easy to form, but the accounting for their income is much more complex than for a single entity like a C corporation. And lots of businesses operate through layers of pass-through entities, you know, with some individuals as owners and some corporations as owners. And the department has had to shift its resources from focusing just on corporations and how they report their income to tracking income of these pass-through entities and watching the money as it flows through the levels of ownership to where it eventually ends up. So that's been a huge change in the environment for taxation.
Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Rabb. Representative Dean?
Professor Strauss spoke about this, but Secretary and Deputy Secretary, this committee looks a lot at tax credits. Can you characterize, and you did talk about it, but I wanted you to give me a little better layman detail, the impact of tax credits, the percentage of tax credits as opposed to our general fund revenues, and the impact of it, the trend of it, and the trend that we ought to be going for?
Yes, we did talk somewhat about the growth of tax credit programs. I can say just administratively that handling tax credits and making sure that they're properly accounted for adds a lot of complexity to the system. And it's not just for the department, it's for taxpayers as well, because a taxpayer who's interested in taking advantage of that kind of credit is going to need to have their staff pay attention to what are the rules of the program and what do I have to do to qualify, and making sure that all the paperwork is in place in order to get a tax credit. The total amount of tax credits in place is in the testimony, and I'm looking for it now. Yes, there was a total of 16 tax credit programs with awards of more than $383 million. And a lot of that is used against the C&I tax, helping to reduce those revenues.
And my second question is in the area of retail sales, and specifically the decline in brick-and-mortar retail sales, the increase in online sales, and the impact. A, how does Pennsylvania deal with that, those lost revenue streams? And B, what is the gravity, the impact of that at this point?
Yes, so the department has put a lot of resources into tackling that very problem. We have 285 auditors, give or take, who work primarily on sales tax issues. We have taken steps to try to make sure that companies that are selling goods in Pennsylvania, that we're looking carefully at them and checking to see if they have nexus so that we can get them to collect tax, for the simple reason that without that, it's not just a revenue issue, it's also we want to avoid situations where companies can be out of state and competing with local businesses without having to contribute their share of the tax burden. I would say we've had a significant amount of success in getting the largest internet sellers to come into compliance. You're probably aware that Amazon collects Pennsylvania sales tax, and a fair number of other internet retailers do as well. I should also mention that the tax bill that just passed and the governor signed into law at the end of October contained an important provision that deals with marketplace sellers and requires the marketplace provider to collect sales tax on behalf of all the companies that are selling goods into Pennsylvania. If they have sales of at least $10,000, then the marketplace provider has to collect tax for them. I think that that's a big step forward. That will help quite a bit. And we're internally, we are focused on administration of that provision.
Well, I was happy with that provision going in as well. And I'm not a big shopper, and I'm really not a big online shopper. But this year, I bought a couple of things through Wayfair, and they advertise no sales tax, free shipping. And so I realize my obligation is at the end of the year to collect those receipts and report what the heck I bought that really should have been subject to sales tax. But as I say, I'm not a big shopper, but I know, you know, it is the trend. It is the way. And it's a very attractive, easy way to shop. But I just think of the bleeding of the sales tax revenue. So hopefully that provision that was passed will make a big difference.
Yes, ultimately, it is a federal issue. But over these many years, the Congress has not acted on it one way or the other. But like I said, I think the new legislation will help us and we'll be able to bring more companies into compliance.
Thank you. Thank you, Representative Daley.
Thank you. When I looked at chart number two with a huge increase in personal income tax revenues, and then compare it to the corporate net income. So I think you explained it, that there are so many more S-corps and limited liability, so that could also be one of the accountings for that big increase in the personal income tax?
Yes.
Okay.
That's right.
The other question I had is, you know, we really need a healthy business community, and we all hear that we heard it again today, that Pennsylvania's corporate taxes are really high. And so I just want to go back to something that hasn't actually been mentioned as far as I've heard today, but that is always brought up around at some point during the year, and that is the idea of combined reporting. And I know that businesses say, oh, it's really difficult, but we also know that I've actually had them say that to me in a hearing. That's why I'm saying that some businesses will say that. But we also understand that many states require combined reporting. And so, and I believe that the governor this past year wanted combined reporting as part of the budget program, but also then wanted to see a decrease in the corporate net income tax. So that's my recollection of it from quite a number of months ago. How does that, do you have information on how that would actually affect the corporate taxes coming into Pennsylvania in making it not, I mean, we don't want to be unfriendly to businesses. We would, and I think we can all agree that we need a healthy business climate in this state.
Well, the governor's proposal was to do what's already been discussed here today, and that is to reduce the rate while broadening the base.
Right.
And that makes it much less burdensome overall economically. And that's exactly what he has proposed to do, I think, on two occasions. Adding combined reporting into the base broadens the base, eliminates a lot of opportunities for tax avoidance, and his proposal was to cut the 9.99 rate down to under 5 to phase in a 4.99 rate. So that would put Pennsylvania well ahead of the pack, and there, I know there's been a lot of discussion about it and concern about the effect of combined reporting. I believe the number is 25 states that have combined reporting at this point. Many of them are some of the fastest growing states in the country. And as long as the rate is low on a combined base, it doesn't seem to be hurting those states. That's the governor's vision of this. And I think getting the rate down is important visually and for competitive reasons.
And my understanding of combined reporting is that the multinational corporations that have presence in multiple states would be the ones who are affected by it, not the corporations that are solely here in Pennsylvania. Is that accurate?
Yes. Combined reporting looks at a group of commonly owned corporations. It's very common these days for a corporation not to be, sort of all by itself and owned by shareholders, and that's it. Most of the time, there will be a corporate entity that's a member of a larger corporate group with lots of subsidiaries and doing related forms of business that contribute to the whole. And combined reporting simply asks the company to report as a group rather than as an individual company.
Okay. And did I hear it correctly that on that, I think it's this chart, that the corporate profits are national?
Yes, that's right.
Okay, because we don't have that information for Pennsylvania. And would we have it if we had combined reporting? I mean, is there a way to get that, or is there some reason we don't have that information for Pennsylvania?
I don't think it's reported on a state-by-state basis, simply because you have to answer how do you apportion that income to an individual state. A lot of corporations be doing business across state lines, and there would be no way to allocate their income by state independently of the tax system.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Representative Daley. Representative Bloom?
Thanks, Eli. Thanks, Mr. Secretary and Madam Deputy Secretary. Any tax that we have in place, obviously, no matter what the tax is, we all have an interest in making sure that it's applied in a fair and uniform manner of taxation we have. And I'm not talking about so much tax avoidance, which generally means you've legally figured out a way not to pay the tax, but tax evasion is kind of the question I want to ask about. In terms of compliance, which of our menu of state taxes do you feel is most susceptible to non-compliance, to evasion, to not really being applied fairly and uniformly? And which one is probably, take the other side of the spectrum, which is the strongest, which is really, really the most fair and uniform? And on the one that's the worst, are there steps that we could take to give you tools to help your enforcement efforts or whatever they may be, investigative efforts, to make sure that it is, that the worst one is made more fair?
Thank you, Representative. That's a great question. Let me answer it in this way. As a general matter, the taxes that are going to have the best compliance level are ones where there's some kind of third-party reporting, right? For example, employers give you a W-2 telling you what your wages were for the year, and that information goes to the Internal Revenue Service and to our department. And the fact that the information comes from a third party who isn't paying the tax means that compliance there is going to be pretty high, right? So that whole system of W-2s and 1099s and et cetera, with reporting information independently of the taxpayer, makes that work pretty well for income tax reporting. Where you don't have third-party reporting, then it becomes much more difficult. And for example, as I mentioned, we put a lot of resources into to combating sales tax fraud and auditing companies on that, because there isn't any independent source of information telling us whether they remitted all of their sales tax. You have to send an auditor there to look at the books and find out whether that happened. So the corporate income tax is based on the federal corporate tax. The line one of the Pennsylvania form is line 28 from the federal return. So again, you have a starting point for a state calculation, and that helps. I don't know if that answers your question, but
which one do you think is where do you suspect or believe that there's the most evasion taking place? Which one of our existing state taxes is most susceptible to that?
I would mention the cigarette tax is being very difficult. for the simple reason that it's easy to drive a truck into Pennsylvania containing a lot of cigarettes from North Carolina or someplace and sell them on the street. And there again, we have a lot of people sort of out on the streets looking for that kind of tax evasion, selling counterfeit cigarettes and that kind of thing. And that's expensive, right? It's more difficult to do that than if we had some sort of information source to rely on.
Do those efforts net more than they cost?
Yes, I'm sure they do. Okay. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Bloom. Representative Keller.
Thank you, Eli, and thank you, Madam Secretary, Mr. Secretary. Just a couple of questions on looking at what we're trying to accomplish here, and some of that is tax policy that would, going forward, probably mirror what would be able to collect our reoccurring revenue. And the question I have, and I didn't see it in the charts, and if I missed it, I apologize. Do we do any comparisons to what how our revenue has grown as compared to the CPI in Pennsylvania?
I don't think we have that with us, but we could certainly look at that.
I think it would be helpful for us to know when our economy is growing, what revenue sources grow, and when it doesn't, what don't. So that's sort of why I asked that. Another question, I noticed on the pie charts, over the 20-year period, I just roughly calculated about an 80% increase mm-hmm. in our tax revenue.
Well, it's closely enough that the that the growth rate would be similar, at
okay.
least.
A question I guess I would have, would we be able to get a comparison that would say if we would have taken the same taxes that we had in the rates in 1996-97 and just grown those to the inflation rate where we would have been? I mean, do we do any kind of analysis, or could we get an analysis that would look like that?
We could do that, sir.
Okay.
Yes. Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Keller. My only real question here is where do nonprofits fit into the overall tax picture in Pennsylvania? There are a lot of nonprofits that receive a lot of money from government. There are a lot of nonprofits that compete against for-profit entities, and those for-profit entities are paying taxes. Do you have an opinion as a secretary of where nonprofits fit in with our long-term tax policy?
The department follows Act 55, which sets out the rules for what's an exempt entity, particularly for sales tax. And in Act 55, our determination of who's an exempt entity then is linked to some degree to who's exempt for local property tax. So those things go together. There are places where the state system is more generous than it is at the federal level. For example, when a large nonprofit has some sort of money-making operation on the side, you can think about the hospital that has the flower shop or the gift shop or the cafeteria or something inside. The exempt entity would have to pay federal income tax on the money they're earning in the flower shop. Right? That doesn't happen at the state level. If you are exempt, if you're an exempt entity and exempt from the corporate tax, then you're exempt for anything that you do. That's one difference in our system.
And if I can just interrupt very briefly, what is the what distinguishes the flower shop within the hospital? Under federal law, what is the distinction that they draw that flower shop competes against other flower shops and therefore it should be treated as a for-profit entity?
I assume that's the rationale. It's a unrelated business income tax. Am I saying that right? Yes. Okay. Which the nonprofit entity would pay at the federal level.
So in the case where that isn't just a flower shop, but say it's a multi-$100 million entity competing against another multi-$100 million for-profit entity, you're saying that there should be some parity?
I wasn't making a proposal, Mr. Chairman, but I was, just giving you that comparison of how it works at the federal level.
Understood. Thank you for your time. Thank you. And running in about 50 minutes behind schedule here, we'll call up Deputy Secretary Rick Vallelo from DCED. I can't believe it. When you're ready, sir.
Good morning. It's a pleasure to be here this morning with you. I'll give you a little bit of my history because I'm a biased witness. My current position is Deputy Secretary of Community and Economic Development at the Department of Community and Economic Development. I started with the state as the Executive Director of the Center for Local Government Services. Prior to that, I was mayor of Lock Haven for 15 years, 3 months, 2 days, and 20 hours. So that tends to bias my opinion. In my the testimony I provided, there's a discussion of local taxes. I don't think any discussion of taxes in Pennsylvania would be complete without talking about the local tax burden. Every property owner in Pennsylvania is under three taxing jurisdictions, the school district, the county, and the local government. When you look at local governments in Pennsylvania, everybody knows the largest, and that's easy, it's the city of Philadelphia. The smallest happens to be East Keating Township in Clinton County with 12 residents. So while I talk in generalities with most of my testimony, there is no one-size-fits-all. We're a very diverse state when you look east to west and north to south. What might work in Montgomery County won't work in Forest County. But in general, real estate taxes bring in over $20 billion when you look at all three taxing jurisdictions. On average, it's over 70% of local government budgets. Some rely 100% on real estate taxes. Some have no real estate taxes. So it varies. There are seven types of non-real estate taxes. They're listed in my testimony. And when you look at DCED's website, there's a really good section of the website called Municipal Statistics. If you go under the link of local government and go into Municipal Statistics, it's where all of the local government information is reported to DCED. So all of the hoops and forms that we make local governments fill out, that information gets collected and reported at the Municipal Statistics website. When you look at the taxing information, there are all 2,560 municipalities listed, but it takes 612 pages to list the forms of local taxes that our citizens have to navigate, whether it be the combination of non-real estate taxes and real estate taxes. One of the things that I think is critical, and it was brought up in several of the testimonies, and it's listed in the appendix that I've provided with my testimony, is the difference in when assessments have taken place in the 67 counties. We vary. Right currently, the oldest is Franklin County, which reassessed in 1961, was the last time it took place. Blair County, prior to that, was 1958, but they just reassessed in 2017. You have 1972, 1975, 1968, 73. Most reassessments don't take place unless there's a court order because of the political pressure that county commissioners are under. So they most know that reassessment's probably the right thing to do on a regular basis, but because of politics, reassessment isn't done on a regular basis. And the other chart that's in my testimony that I think is really, really interesting is every local government is a child of the state through either the third class city code or township codes or borough codes. And the millage rate that local municipalities are allowed, the maximum millage rate that they're allowed to charge is set in those codes. And they vary from 10 mils up to 32 and a quarter mils. And school district personnel costs and debt service are unlimited. When you look at what the millage rate that they're allowed to charge. So when we look at municipal tax reform, there are definite advantages to real estate taxes, and there are definite challenges to real estate taxes. The advantages are it's a budgetable number. Year in, year out, you know what your collection rate is, and over a three-year period, that collection rate gets virtually to 100%, and it doesn't fluctuate. So when we're looking at funding everything from pre-K to prisons with real estate taxes, having a budgetable number is very, very important. I'll open it up to questions because I know we're behind schedule and we just can't get into all of the issues.
Thank you, Rick. No, I appreciate it. And this is just the beginning of the discussion. All the different taxes you had listed, and I appreciate your testimony. Do you have a number on the total taxes collected by local governments?
I can get the exact figure. I know it's over 20.
Real estate, income, everything. This whole list, to just add them all together.
It would be over $24 billion.
Okay.
The average family that owns property in Pennsylvania pays more in local taxes than they do in state taxes.
And that number, I would want to include the earned income per capita, yeah, occupation.
I can get that.
My question is, can you talk a little bit about, if I'm a single member LLC filing for a business that I owned in the city of Harrisburg, would be an example, living in a different county, I would be responsible for paying an earned income tax, a mercantile tax, an LST tax, a income tax to the home jurisdiction that I lived, and I'm sure there are ones that I'm forgetting, City of Harrisburg school district tax and a school district tax where I was living. Can you talk a little bit about how you view the consolidation of local taxes through Act, what was it, 32. And where we could go. Like, is there a benefit to going a little bit farther?
Absolutely. 100% yes. Act 32, just from the consolidation and better collections, brought in $176 million more to local governments. So the average local government saw about a 20% increase just because of more efficient collection. If we looked at all of the nuisance taxes and consolidating the collection, I would think you would see a similar 20% increase. Maybe not as much because but you would see a significant increase in collections just through more efficient collections.
Representative Wheatley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sorry, Eli. And thank you, Deputy Secretary, for being here. I wanted to really, I wanted to ask this question to all of the presenters, but I know we have limited time. One of the problems I think we have when we go into these conversations, again, it's hard for us as policymakers, and it's hard for you as the people who have to implement policies and laws to think beyond just the day and now of the stresses of trying to get the day and now. But my hope is that we are going to take this opportunity to not get stuck in today and now, but to think about what the future could be based off of some shared values and some shared understandings. And from the beginning of this process, history and context matter. Like, why things were done the way that they were done hundreds of years ago, when were they changed, how were they changed, what were they changed for, and then looking to where are we trying to be are things that, you know, internally we need to struggle with. I think the question around taxes, we always talk about it in the void of what we're taxing for, right? Because that's a value proposition, I think I heard this earlier, that will drive, you know, where we might do more of something because we're trying to, because it's more of a value and a priority for us. But if we are never going to take a step back and say, what are the value propositions that the citizens of Pennsylvania expect their government to pay for? And then ask ourselves, are we doing it in an efficient, fair, equitable manner? And then can we sustain it into where we want to be? Now, those are all big, grand questions that none of us here can answer by ourselves. But why I said that long-winded diatribe to you is because at some point, there is this question around, should we have all this taxing separate authorities? And if so, what's the appropriate mix? There are some specific reasons why we wanted to give local authorities the ability to tax the way that they do. All of these things are critical. And I've been here 15 years, and I can't say I'm really understanding it. I just follow along, and I add to, you know, a vote here and there to give them more or take some away. But I would, what do you think are the appropriate mix of tax authority that we should have, either from a state perspective or give locals themselves to do it?
Wow. I'm going to put my mayor's hat on. And one of the things that I always thought when I was mayor is, you know, what services should we be providing? So nobody ever came to me and say, Mayor, we need less policemen. Nobody ever came to me and said, hey, you guys are doing too good a job plowing the streets. You know, that never happened. Nobody ever said that, you know, we don't need that traffic light at that intersection Saturday and Sunday. We want you to turn that traffic light off. You know, those are things that we do every day. But when we look statewide, and I'm not going to say merger or consolidation because that's like having a discussion about taxing pensions. You know, they're dirty words, but we need to look at what services we want to provide and how we're going to provide them. You know, and one of the things I always say, if New York City, the five boroughs of New York City can work together, then we can work with our core communities in a more efficient manner. So, you know, when you look at real estate tax reform, I don't think the discussion is completely replacing real estate taxes because of their budgetability. So how are we, what are we going to replace real estate taxes with, and what are we going to fund with that replacement? Is it going to be school districts or some other combination? Right now, we fund too much with real estate taxes. But 20 years from now, when we're looking at real estate taxes, you know, how are we assessing the value of real estate taxes? You know, if there is a $100,000 house in Lower Merion, you know, is the $100,000 house in Lower Merion assessed at the same rate as a $100,000 house in Lock Haven? You know, is the assessment done on a regular basis so that it's being done in a fair manner? And if we look at all of the taxes, and figure out what we want to fund for the next 10, 20, 30 years. You know, that I think is getting to a more fair and equitable place. You know, we have amusement taxes on tickets to go to stadiums that we give huge tax exemptions to. You know, so the taxpayer is subsidizing the building and then paying an amusement tax. I mean, there's something wrong with that combination.
Thank you. And then I have Representative Daley, maybe for a comment.
I served in local government for 20 years, and I just wanted to say that I thought your explanation, putting your mayor's hat on, was really good, because my experience in local government was that we were paying for services that people wanted. And I remember one discussion that my borough is completely surrounded by Lower Merion Township, and they wanted to come in and provide us police services, and they said they could save us a lot of money. And we never had a meeting with more people telling us how important the local police department was. We found out they also didn't really have any idea that there was not a Narberth police officer there at all times. But the vehemence and the passion that people had for their local police department in a little half-square mile borough, the only reason we could function was because we had Lower Merion completely surrounding us. But I think the issue is that in local government, you really can make that connection. And having 2,516 local governments, is that the number?
2,560. 12 pages
Perfect.
Of Excel spreadsheet.
Thank you so much for being here today.
Any other questions? No? Thank you so much for your testimony. Local taxes are always very difficult. I think the only distinction that we need to understand from where we sit is that we're not executives. Local governments are executives, so they have the power to tax and the power to spend. We lack the power to actually execute on that plan, and that's what makes this difficult. But there have been areas that have undergone transitions, and I think that's what we need to focus on as we put our recommendations forward.
Absolutely.
So might look like a very difficult process from the outside, but others have done it and love
it's,
what's
it's
happened.
It's hard, but it's so important, yeah. And it really, really needs to be done.
Thank you. With that, the hearing is adjourned.